Thank you for choosing to watch this sermon preached at Heritage Baptist Church. Heritage Baptist Church is located at 1843 Peeksville Road, Locust Grove, Georgia, 30248. You can contact us at 770-320-7771. Visit us on the web at www.hbcga.com.
I want you to open your Bibles to the book of 2 Kings chapter 20. 2 Kings chapter 20 this morning. Boy, we're going to read the account of a king and what God did in his life. But brother, what God said to this king, he'll say to every one of us one day. Look in 2 Kings chapter 20. And if we can, let's begin reading in verse 1. In those days was Hezekiah sick unto death. Now, I don't know how many times Hezekiah had been sick before. I don't know how many times that he had, I don't know what sickness that he had. Maybe he got sick and got better. He got sick and maybe it was a long period of time, but then he got better. But the Bible says this, that he was sick this time unto death. It was that sickness that he was not going to recover from. It was that sickness that he would meet God with. And the prophet Isaiah, the son of Amoz, came to him and said unto him, thus saith the Lord, set thine house in order, for thou shalt die and not live. Now, brother, can you imagine the preacher coming down? You called me over to your house and you're sick and you're wanting the preacher to pray with you. And I know what you are. Oh, Lord, preacher, pray with me. Ask the Lord to touch me. Ask God to help me. Preacher, I'd love for the Lord to, I know God's no respecter of persons, but I'd love for the Lord if he'd have in his mercy, if he would touch me. And oh, I don't want this going on in my life. Preacher, would you pray for me? And imagine my comforting words instead were, set thine house in order, for thou shalt die and not live. Now Isaiah, I don't know how he said that. I don't think he said it flippantly. I think it was a matter of fact, because it was thus saith the Lord. He said, I've got a word from you from God. Now can I tell you this? That's what I said a minute ago. Every one of us, one of these days, are going to stand before the Lord. The Bible says it's appointed unto men once to die, and after this, the judgment. There's certain things, there's things that are sure in this life. Brother, as sure as you were born, one day we will die. I said, one day we will die. I'm not looking forward to that day. I'm not sitting around dwelling on that day, but I know it will come to pass. I understand that. We're born into this world in a fleshly body. This body is not made to live forever. This body fails us in so many ways. Sometimes when you're young, sometimes when you're old. But I'm not dealing with the natural side of it. He said, thou shalt die and not live. But I like what he said, and what he was telling this, what he even told the king was, set thine house in order. In other words, it's time to get right, buddy. It's time to get right. Now, when I go to read my Bible and I go to study, there's reasons and there's times when we ought to. I mean, brother, if you're going to set your house in order, I think if somebody came and said, look, you're going to die. You know what? You're going to start setting some things in order. Man, you're going to get some things ready. You're going to get some things laid out. There's going to be some preparation there. Oh, brother, the heartache that comes along with a loved one that meets God, there's no describing that. But can I tell you, preparing ahead of time sure will help those that are going to be left here. Oh, brother, preparing, setting your house. So there's certain things you might do on an earthly side to set your house in order. But can I say, if I knew that I was going to leave this earth and I'm about to meet my God, I'm about to stand before God. Oh, dear brother, I tell you what I'm going to do. I want my life to be right. I tell you, I want things to be right with God. I mean, if I think I'm going to be in the presence of God, if the preacher or God has come down and said, thou shalt die and not live, then I'm telling you, brother, it's time to get things right. If I'm going to die, I'm going to do that. Can I give you another reason we ought to do that? If I'm going to be a disciple, I need to do that. If I'm going to be a real disciple of the Lord, a follower of Christ, a disciple is a pupil, a student, is somebody that Jesus had the 12 disciples. Really, there's more than that, but he had those initial 12. And you understand, they followed him. They walk with him. Brother, they serve with him. They learn from him. Brother, they're living for him with you and I. Brother, I want to be a good disciple of the Lord Jesus Christ. I mean, brother, he's my Savior. He's your Savior. You ought to be a follower of God. You ought to be a follower of our Savior. Brother, he deserves that. He desires that. But I'll tell you this, he demands that. Oh, no doubt, brother. Amen. Well, I don't know. I'm kind of flipping a coin on whether or not I'm going to be a disciple or not. No. If you're saved, you ought to be a disciple. If you're saved, you ought to be a follower of Jesus Christ. You ought to be one that says, I want God to be first. I want to live for God. I want to honor God with my life. Can I tell you, we ought to do that. But if I'm going to be, if I choose to be a disciple, then I need to set my house in order. If I'm going to really be a good disciple, I need to set my house in order. If I'm going to die, I need to set my house in order. Let me give you another thing. The Bible says over in Jude, and if some have compassion, making a difference. If I'm going to make a difference, I better set my house in order. Now, if I'm just going to live my life and it ain't really going to matter and I'm not looking to influence anybody for Christ, or really others don't matter, it's just about how I want to live and what I want to do for me, and that's my life, then that's one thing. But if I don't make a difference in the life of others, then I better set my house in order. Yep. We were talking about, I had two or three families I visited yesterday, and it seemed like the same theme was going on with what we were dealing with. One day we're going to come down to the end of life. And you're going to look at it and you're going to say, what did I do with the life God gave me? If you're saved, you're going to look and say, what did I do with the ministry that God gave me? If you got a family, you're going to look at that family and say, what have I done with this family that God gave me? You see, we come down, brother, we begin to look at those things, then I tell you what we want to be able to say. We want to be able to look at our family and say, I made a difference in my family. We want to be able to look at a ministry and say, I made a difference in that ministry. By the way, you look at the ministry at this church, I look at it as a pastor, and I say, Lord, I want to make a difference. You ought to look at this church as a church member and say, Lord, I want to make a difference in my church. I want to be something for God. I want to live for God and honor God, but I want to make a difference. If you're going to do that, you got to set your house in order. You got to set your house in order. Man, and by doing that, notice what he did. Look with me, if you will, in verse 2. He did the right thing when he heard that news. The Bible says, then he turned his face to the wall and prayed unto the Lord, saying, I beseech thee, O Lord, remember now how I have walked before thee in truth and with perfect heart, and have done that which is good in thy sight. And Hezekiah wept sore. And it came to pass, before Isaiah was gone out into the middle court, that the word of the Lord, boy, that was quick, came unto him, saying, turn again. Tell Hezekiah, the captain of my people, thus saith the Lord God of David, thy father, I have heard thy prayer, and I have seen thy tears. Behold, I will heal thee. And on the third day thou shalt go up unto the house of the Lord. And I will add unto thy days 15 years. And I will deliver thee and this city out of the hand of the king of Assyria. And I will defend the city for mine own sake and for my servant David's sake. Now, I'll stop reading right there because, the Lord healed him right there. And I like that. The Lord said, he said, I'm going to heal you. And he said, by the way, he said, right after I do that, he said, you're going back to the right place and you're going to stay in the right place. You're going back to the house of God. Somebody say amen. Yep. And I just tell you this, you say, preacher, when God does something for somebody, should they come to the house of God? You better believe they ought to. But I tell you this, before God ever does that, man, we ought to go back to the house of God. I'm talking about get back under the word of God, get back in the presence of God. I believe we can do that. I believe we ought to do that. I believe God blesses us for doing that. Man, there's nothing like going to church. preacher, you're just the preacher. You got to like church. I love the house of God, man. I love God's people. I love being around this singing. I love being around. I'm doing the preaching and I'm loving it, amen. Oh, yeah. Man, a preacher that don't enjoy his own preaching, something's wrong with him. I can tell you that. But I know this. I know when I think about this matter, setting your house in order, then he's saying, you got to get some things right, buddy. You got to get some things right. First thing I think about when I think of things, right? You know, when the old timers, when the doctor would come in and say, you're going to die and not live. They used to make statements like this. Somebody would tell him, brother, you need to make your peace with God. You ever heard that saying? Raise your hand if you've ever heard that. You need to make your peace with God. Brother, you better know that what they're saying is you better make it right with God. Now, he's not talking about getting something right in your life. He's saying, look, you better get saved if you're not saved. Can I tell you something? If you're going to die one day, which we are, then brother, why in the world would you go one more day lost? If you're not saved, you ought to get saved today. I'm saying if you're not saved this morning, you ought to get saved this morning. If I would not risk walking out those doors lost, I would not risk it one second. Max, one of the young men, they've been coming. And I saw him the other day. They got back in. They've been coming to church. And he's not here this morning. He had one of them motorcycles and he wrecked on it. Yesterday, I believe, he was down close to a friend's house, but he's just super sore, and he's laid up in the bed this morning. But, oh, man, I'm grateful that he's recovering from that. Oh, I could not imagine if she would have come in weeping, and she would have said, oh, preacher, we were just talking with you Wednesday night, and let me tell you about the tragedy that's happened. Hey, but you know what? Old Max, way back when he was a teenager coming to this church, when he rode in on a church bus, he asked the Lord to come in his heart and save him. Amen. You see, the Lord saved that young man. And God made a difference in his life. And you see, he's going to heaven one of these days when he does meet the Lord, because he put his faith in Jesus Christ. You know what he did? He made it right with God when it comes to this matter of salvation. Let me help you with something. You can't make it right by going to church enough. No. Oh, preacher, that's why I've started coming back to church, because I want to feel better about my eternity and meeting God. Can I help you with something? Going to church don't get you saved. Showing up here at the church don't get you saved. Doesn't make you, going to church don't make you a Christian no more than going to the barn makes you a horse. You get it? You understand? You sit now. What? Show me in the Bible where it says if you walk in those doors and sit on a pew that you have eternal life. It doesn't say that, does it? Bible doesn't teach that. Bible doesn't preach that. The Bible doesn't show us that. And so what the Lord's saying is you don't get there by just showing up at church. Let me give you something else. You don't get there. You don't make things right with God by doing good enough. I'll tell you what I'll do. I'm going to start treating people different, and I'm going to be nice to my wife. I'll be nice to my husband. Boy, that'll be a miracle in any house. All right, amen. But y'all didn't laugh at that. That was funny right there. Y'all should have laughed, amen. I'm telling you, I'm going to change. I'm going to turn over a new leaf. You know the problem? It's the same old rotten leaf on the other side. Turning over a new leaf. I'm going to change and do a little different. I'm going to modify my life. I'm going to try to fit it. Look, a lost person trying to be saved is like a square peg trying to go in a round hole. You will never do it. You can try. You can try to act like a saved person. You can try to talk like a saved person. But hey, modifying behavior don't get you to heaven. Amen. You don't get to heaven by changing a few things in your life. You don't get to heaven just by doing a little different. And I'm just not going to act like I did, or talk like I did, or go where I went. Look, the Bible says, by grace are you saved through faith. And that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. So we understand salvation, when it comes to making things right with God, that's not, you don't get there by I'm going to do better. I'm going to go to church. I've seen some that even said, preacher, baptize me. Baptize me, preacher. You know, and again, that's where, you know, the husband says, I want to get baptized. And the wife slips me a 50 and says, hold him under. Hey, man, 100 gets him down for a long time. I'm just kidding. But I can tell you this. Hey, getting wet doesn't do a thing for you. You can get baptized. They used to baptize in the rivers and baptize in the ponds. Heard the old preachers would say you could get baptized in every river until you know every bullfrog by name, but that don't get you to heaven. Amen. You don't get to heaven by getting baptized. Preacher, I've trusted that baptism. My mama told me I got baptized when I was little, so I must be okay. When somebody asks me if I'm going to heaven, I immediately say, well, yeah, I got baptized. Hey, that, you don't get to heaven by getting wet. Baptism is for believers only. Baptism is something that takes place after you've been saved, after you put your faith in Christ. If you're trusting getting to heaven, you understand, set thine house in order means make it right with God. You don't make it right with God in just getting in a baptistry. You don't make it right with God, get joining a church. You don't just make it right with God. Let me tell you how you make it right with God. You come to God like you are. Amen. A lost sinner on your way to hell. God, I'm a sinner, and I admit I am. I can't get to heaven on my own. In fact, God, if I die a lost sinner, I will die and go to hell. And I admit that, God. I'm not hiding that. I'm not trying to cover that up. So you get real honest with God. We live in a day where we're professional liars. Don't look at me like that. We are. We get professional at it. We've done so much of it, you know. And just people lie, you know. Does this dress make me look fat? You about to lie, aren't you guys? Yeah, you are. You're smart. No, I'm just kidding. And a man, you know, honey, I ain't gained no weight, have I? She's like, Lord help, son. She looks at you. Hey, now you're shade in the summer and warmth in the winter, fella. Amen. I'm telling you. Yes, you've gained some weight, but she ain't going to tell you that, you know. We lie. You lie about little things and we think, well, that's all right. But I want to tell you, for goodness sake, don't lie to yourself about being saved. Because you ain't hurting nobody but yourself when it comes to telling that lie. I'm good. I'm fine. I prayed one time when I was a little. Of course, I live like the devil. Ain't nothing right in my life. I ain't got no conviction in my life. I have no desire for church. But I got saved. Oh, okay. Now, look, I don't got to stand before God with you. I don't have to stand before God with you. See, the Bible says, examine yourselves whether ye be in the faith. You and God, nobody else. Not you and husband, not you and wife. Not you and mom and daddy, not you and children, not you and preacher, not you and anybody. One day you'll stand before God, and the wise preacher will say to everyone sitting here today, set thine house in order. Set your house in order. Make it right with God. Come to God. Lord, I'm a lost sinner. I'm on my way to hell. God, I can't get to heaven. I'm not going to pretend like I am. I'm not going to hide behind, somebody telling me I'm saved. I want to know I'm saved. And Lord, I want to come to you a lost sinner. And God, Jesus, I believe you're the Son of God. I believe you died for me. I believe you rose again. And you're in heaven today. And you shed your blood for me on Calvary. And I believe your blood can wash my sins away. I believe without a shadow of a doubt, if I ask you to save me, you will save me. The Bible says, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Now, I'm telling you what, I remember bowing down as a 15-year-old boy. I mean, brother, just a rebellious, lost boy in a drunkard's home, bowed on my knees and called on God and asked God to save me. And I want to tell you what, he came in my heart, he forgave me of my sins, and you know what I did that day? I made it right with God. Have you made it right with God? Have you made it right? You stand before God. Look, now with me, there's no doubt. I don't wonder about it. Because I know my salvation's not based on me. Man, I don't got to trust Terrell Hopkins. I don't got to trust. I preach and I do these things. But hey, I ain't got to trust any of that. You know what I did the night I got saved? I put my faith and my trust in Jesus Christ. Hey, for me to die and go to hell, I'd have to be the first one that God ever denied heaven because they had their faith in Jesus Christ. Amen. That ain't happening. I'll tell you that. That ain't happening. You understand this matter of making it right. If you're not saved, make it right today. I'll wait till next Sunday. What if you don't live till next Sunday? Be ashamed to die and go to hell planning on getting saved next Sunday. Brother, get saved today. Don't wait another day. Don't waste another day. The Bible says, Jesus said in John chapter 14 and verse 6, I am the way and the truth and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. There is no other way. You go through Jesus Christ, or there is no other way. Preacher, I believe in Jesus. I didn't say, do you know about him here? Have you ever put your faith in him here? Amen. Did he change your life? Do you love him today? Do you know he's in your heart? Do you know without a shadow of a doubt that if you died right now, you'd go to heaven? You see, you got to make it right. I'm spending more time on that making it right. Because the next thing is, there's plenty of us that are saved. And if God walked down our way, or if God sent the preacher down to our house and said, man, I've got a message from God, thus saith the Lord. And he says, how many of you are saved? Raise your hand. You have been saved. Oh, yeah. There's a lot all over this church. So then, look. So now he's talking to you. And the preacher comes down and he says, set thine house in order, for thou shalt die and not live. What's got to change in your life? You're about to die and not live. Hey, then you know what? All of that sin, it sure does look little now, don't it? When I grew up in a drunkard's home, I said, we had a full stop bar downstairs. My dad got saved on July 18th of 1982. He got the check stubs that year. He got the check stubs from January till that July the 18th. He had spent over $3,000 at the Lilburn liquor store. That's the checks. That's not counting any cash. That's just at that one store. That's not counting any other store or counting any restaurants and all that other. I grew up in a drunkard's home and all the mess that goes along with it. I'll just tell you this. That life ain't got nothing to hold on God, on a Christian life. Preacher, you don't understand. I love that life. I love the way that what I've been doing. And man, it's got a hold of me. It's what sin does. But if God comes down and says, set your house in order, thou shalt die and not live, makes that drinking look real small, don't it? In fact, you're like, wait a minute. God's way more important. And I'm about to be standing in front of God. Because think about it. Who do you please when you drink? Maybe yourself. What, the people around you? When you die, you ain't standing in front of that crowd. You stand in front of God Almighty. Only one life will soon be passed. Only what's done for Christ will last. Set thine house in order. He's saying it's one thing to make things right, but what he's saying to the Christian is, you better get some things right with me. The Bible says your sins have separated between you and your God. Sins. The things that God said, that God says, this is what you got to get right. Let me ask you, if you're about to meet God today, I'm telling you, me and Melissa, how old were we whenever they came and they thought I had leukemia and they were running all those tests? How old were we then? How old were the kids? Remember? The kids were 6. Bridget was 6. David was 3. Man, I got sick. I was on a church bus one day and my gums were bleeding. And I was like, man, what is going on? They were bleeding and I had all this other stuff going on. And I go to the doctor. The doctor looks there, looks at all this stuff, and he starts drawing blood, and he takes that blood, and he says, we got to send this off. And he said, I said, I'm a preacher. I said, what? You don't got to hide it from me. Now, wait, tell me what you're thinking. He said, preacher, we had a lady come in here about 2 weeks ago with the exact same thing going on with you. She's got acute something leukemia. He said, right now she's in the middle of chemo. He said, we don't know if she's going to make it. He said, I mean, it's so far advanced. And he said, we've got to test you. He said, I think it's the same thing. I'm telling you what, brother, I was already sick as a dog. I mean, but I went home and I turned my face to the wall and I prayed. Here's the first thing. Oh, dear God, I go back to that night that I got saved. And I want to tell you, as I went back to that night, my anchor holds. I know without a shadow of a doubt, I put my faith in the Lord Jesus, and he saved me. I mean, a doctor telling me that, I'm like, I don't even know what to do. And I'm like, man, I'm young married. I've got these young children, and I got a life in front of me, and what am I going to do? And so, of course, I'm like, well, the main thing is, if I'm going to die, Lord, I mean, I preach to everybody, I know I'm going to heaven when I die. Well, I went back to that night. In my heart, I went back to that night, and I know without a doubt, Jesus Christ saved me. It's his blood. It's his. So that was all taken care of. Let me tell you the second thing I did. Laying on that bed. Oh, dear God, forgive me for my foolish sins. Lord, anything, and I mean, I was trying to think of anything and everything that could be between me and God. Thinking of everything I'd ever done that was so stupid, so foolish. That's what sin is anyway. So it really, when you look at it like that, sin all of a sudden, instead of being so big and so fun, it started looking so small and so grotesque. And honestly, laying there, I think I'm about to die. Why in the world, being a child of God, have I ever wasted 1 second on this foolishness?
Amen.
That's what's here. Sin, it had no allurement right then. It had no great temptation right then. Because I'm sitting there, I'm looking at it, I think, the way that God looks at it. See, God got me down to a place thinking I was about to meet him. And I'm looking at that, and I'm like, oh, Lord. So you know what I'm doing? I'm getting right. I'm getting right. Getting things right in my heart. I see people all in the Bible that did that. Prodigal son left home, went off, wasted his substance on riotous living. But there came a day when he remembered all the goodness over at the Father's house. How many in the servants in my Father's house have bread and enough to spare, and I perish with hunger? I will arise and go to my Father. And I'll say unto him, Father, I've sinned against heaven and before thee, and am no more worthy to be called thy son. Make me as one of the hired servants. And so he made his way back. And all I'll tell you is this. Boy, he sure had done the father wrong. He sure had treated him wrong. But the Bible says when he was yet a great way off, the father saw him. You know what that tells me? That if any one of us this morning decide I'm getting right with God, I'm turning back to God. When you're a great way off, the Father's going to see you. You see, because getting right, God doesn't make it impossible to get right. We just have to, you know what hinders people from getting right? They won't admit they're wrong. Doesn't seem like it's so obvious. You'd think everybody would know that. But you see, when you begin to get things right, there's going to be some things God's going to have to forgive you of. There's going to be some things you're going to need to forsake in your life. Preacher, that's the same stuff. I need to ask God to forgive me, and I need to forsake that stuff. You're right. But think about the things that you do wrong. Now, sometimes all of your sin doing is all private. It's all by yourself. But a lot of times the sin that takes place or the wandering that takes place is because of the crowd we hang around with. The Bible says, wherefore come out from among them and be ye separate, saith the Lord, and touch not the unclean thing. The Bible says, talking about people doing a lot of that stuff, it says, and be not partakers with them. Yeah, preacher, they're my friends, and man, they do this and they do that. But the Bible says you don't have to be a partaker with them. And the Lord started convicting. When I was a young man, the Lord started convicting me. I mean, I would be with the people, but I wouldn't be doing it. But you know what the Lord convicted me about then? He said, hey, but somebody rides by and all that crowd's over there doing it, but you're with them. Now, with that crowd, they know you're not doing it, but the crowd that rides by, they're like, here's Hopkins, he's part of that. The Lord convicted me about where I went, who I was with.
Amen.
And what was going on while I was there. See, if you're not careful, you got to be careful, because there's those that when you're with them, let me help you. Satan gets in our life, and Satan messes up our fellowship, our friendship with God. We're not as friendly with God as we used to be. Man, used to, we would do any kind of favor for God, anything God, if we could do something extra for God, we'd do it. But when we're not where we ought to be with God, we don't do that. And I mean, you go to thinking about all that. A husband and a wife. Husbands and wives, whenever they're good and they're going great, everything, man, the fellowship is wonderful. They love spending time together, going places together, talking together. And the fellowship is great. When things get wrong, there's no fellowship anymore.
Amen.
You quit talking. You quit spending time with each other. By the way, where's the friendship? Used to, there's nobody you'd rather spend time with than him. And in that home, see what's happened? Man, there's some things that are wrong. Set thine house in order might mean a marriage ought to get where it ought to be today.
Right.
It might mean that you realize, man, we're not even friendly to each other. We live in the same home, and we're not even friendly. We're not friends. We're not friendly. We treat other, I said this Wednesday night, but we can treat, be careful if you can treat a total stranger and you can be nice and friendly and upbeat with them, and then you treat your own family like garbage. So you got to be careful of that. Preacher, that doesn't happen. That happens in Christian homes. Hey, Christian homes. Now, daddies, all you men, look up here at me. Men, if you're a man and you've got a wife, you got a home, then you are the spiritual leader of your home. Now, whether you're a good leader or a bad leader is total up to you. Are you a man that leads your family? Do you lead them to church? Do you lead them to serve God? Do you lead them to love God? Do we lead them that way? I was with the teenagers this morning, and I'm dealing with them on a different level. They're going back to school, and I was talking about Daniel and how Daniel's Savior was first. Then he stood firm, and then he was a soul-winning fanatic. I was dealing with that. But then I turned it around. I said, you're about to go back to school. You're going to go with a bunch of people. Man, you're about to be around that old crowd. I said, here's what you got to do. You got to say no to sin. Somebody say amen right there. Let me help you. Mom, dad, grown adult, you got to say no to sin. I told the young people, you got to say no to sex. Say amen. Preacher, that's so foreign, man. You don't you know how kids live today? Hey, I know how God wants them to live. By the way, did you know that's not just for the teenagers? I've got grown adults, and you grown adults date, and here's what you think. I'm a grown adult. I can do what I want to do, man. I'm divorced, man. I understand life. So I've got a license now because I'm divorced, and I can do just about what I want to when it comes. Let me tell you something. You still ought to live a clean, pure, moral life. Amen. Hey, you're making out with a girl and she's not your wife. That's as much sin as anything else. And you do anything else like that, that's a wicked sin. Never has been popular being the preacher. Hey, never has been popular being the preacher. See, right now you're half cock mad. I tell you what, you ain't going to tell me what to do. Hey, you better let God tell you what to do there, big boy. Oh, I'm a man. Then show yourself a man. Be a godly man, not a worldly man. Worldly man treats, does with a woman what the world does. A godly man keeps a woman and stays pure until the day that he gets married. That's what a godly man does. A man that walks with God does that. A young person that would lead another one away from church, keep them out of a Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night, or Sunday school? Hey, absolutely. I tell the young people, get away from them. You don't need them in your life. I tell you grown adults, you got a grown adult that keeps you out for whatever reason of a Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night. Just go spend time with me. Why would you put somebody in a position where they got to choose either you or God? Hey, that doesn't seem fair, does it? And I'll tell you, this ain't right. Go ahead and preach on it, you know. All right, coming back tonight. I didn't figure you would. That's why I'm saying it this morning. Amen. Amen. Come on. You know what needs to be? You might just need to get some things right. Don't be so hard-headed you won't get something right. You hear me? Hey, maybe I better just say that better. Let's don't be so hard-hearted we won't get things right. Them couples, hey, let's go back to you married couples. That's good. You thought I was done with you. Now you're like, you're hiding over there. Man, he's done now. He ain't going to say nothing else about our fellowship because we ain't fellowshipping like we ought to. We ain't been friendly like we ought to. Hey, how about those favors? Just doing the little extras. You don't do those when you get wrong. You only do them when you're right. How about that fondness? It's a husband and wife. There ought to be some affection somewhere. Genuine affection. I love you. Say it. Write it. Show it. You gotta be careful whenever that. Hey, you gotta wait. See, there's some things that ought to get right in a home whenever that affection's not where it ought to be, whenever the friendship's not where it ought to be, the favor, the fellowship. See, all of those things. Getting right, making it right. I'm saved. I'm going to heaven. Okay, but let's get it right. Let's get our life right. And by getting your life right, it's not saying, okay, let's take a survey of these people. Do they think my life's right? No, y'all. I'm talking about pleasing God. It's just simple, ain't it? pleasing God. What does he want? Lord, are we a couple that pleases you? And here's, if I really want some help, I don't say this. God, there's some things about my wife you need to change. I'm not getting help if that's all I'm doing. Boy, I tell you, if you'd fix her. Now, I'm really about to get some help when I'm like, Lord, it's me. It's me. It's me, oh Lord. Stand in need of prayer, God. Because if you change me, my wife probably, the truth is, if the Lord changes me like I ought to, then I'm going to start really probably appreciating my wife like I ought to. And a wife that says, I'm going to put the Lord first, she starts appreciating that husband again. And the Lord starts to help them reconcile. The answer is not divorce. The answer is not let's leave each other. The answer is not let's split up. The answer is let's remember how it could be. Let's repent. And then by the grace of God, let's reconcile. Let's get it right. Charlie and Connie, that was a unique situation. I used to laugh. I mean, you know, her saying was, Charlie! Just like that one. And that man could aggravate that woman more than any man I've ever seen in my life. Couldn't he? He was a professional agitator. You're like, no, my husband's got that. No, Charlie Baker had that, amen. But can I tell you what? You talk about two people loving each other. You talk about two people, hey, fellowshipping. And if they got something wrong, they were quick to get it right. Is that right? Now, I love Miss Connie. I love Brother Charlie. I love that family. And I'm not saying that to bring up in her heart, because she loves that man, still loves him. And he ain't been gone very long. But let me just say, can I say this? She'd give anything right now for that man to be sitting next to her, aggravating her. It's just the way it is. Y'all, we don't live here forever. One day, my wife's going to walk down here and maybe she'll be, yeah. Maybe I'll be laying in a casket and she'll be like, yes. Bye-bye. I don't think she'll be that way. She may be like, hello, insurance. Hey, we cut up about it, but truth is, man, I heard Brother Howes preach a message one time on Would God I Had. He said that woman goes back to a home and she said she walks in a house. It's like when the kids leave. You walk in that room and you wish it was messed up again so you could clean it up. You wish there were some balls laying around where they had left them. You go in a room and it's silent. You wish there was in there hollering so you could be like, hush. But they're gone. I grew up. Woman walks back in that house and he described it. He said she folds clothes out of a dryer for the last time that she'll never fold again. Says she looks at a picture of them someplace and remembers the embrace. But that's all she can just remember it now. You see, if we're not careful, we waste a life over things that are nothing. We argue over things that are nothing. We get upset and apart over things that, honestly, they're nothing. Because the truth is, look, I look back at Miss Hopkins, man, oh man. Man, I love Miss Hopkins. Oh yeah. And I can't even dwell on that. I can't even dwell on thinking about that. I don't want to. I want to prepare, but I don't. I can't even dwell. Brother Hopkins, boy, that strong preacher. Weak man right here. Weak man. Without God, brother, I am nothing and you are too. Man, I can't imagine Terrell Hopkins without Melissa Hopkins. I'm a mess. So you understand, we got to get things right. Let's make it right. Get it right with God. Get it right with each other. Get things out of our life. Get the right things in our life. If I had time, I'd preach about staying right. By staying right, you have to have commitment. There's got to be some commitment, consecration to God. God, thank you for getting these things out of my life. Thank you for changing. Thank you for reconciling. Thank you for getting these things right. Lord, I've made it right a long time ago. I'm saved. But God, I've gotten some things right, and I want it to stay that way. Everybody turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 15 and look in verse 58. Turn to 1 Corinthians 15. Look right there. Quick. 1 Corinthians chapter 15 and verse 58. 1 Corinthians chapter 15 and verse 58. Because the second thing is this. You make that commitment and that consecration to God. But to stay right, there's going to have to be some consistency in our Christian life. Let me see. The Bible says, therefore, my beloved brethren, he's talking to saved people, you and I that are born again believers, you've already made it right. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be ye steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, for as much as you know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. Man, that's one of my favorite verses. It speaks to my heart. It helps me keep on going. How do you stay consistent? How do you keep from being up and down and like a yo-yo and like a merry-go-round, just up and down and round and round and getting off where you got on? I tell you how. Be steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord. Sounds like somebody involved in their church. Sounds like somebody working for God. Sounds like somebody serving God. Always abounding in the work of the Lord. And then he reminds us, for as much as you know, that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. See, that marriage is a good work. And when you put forth that work into that good work, God, the Bible says, for as much as you know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. That work of God over at the church is a good work. And when you put yourself into that work, that for as much as you know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. You got that family, you're raising those children. Hey, for as much as you know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. God says, oh, I'm going to reward that. Man, I'll reward that. I'll reward that because you made things right a long time ago. I'm rewarding that because you got things right with me, but I'm rewarding that, praise God, because you stayed right. You know, there's just something about those that, man, they get in, they get right, and they stay right. But the good thing is, you said, preacher, I got in and I got right, but I got wrong again. And then I got right and I got wrong again. What do I do? Get right again. Kind of simple. Get right again. Get right again. What do I do after that? Get right again. What do I do after that? Get right again. Preacher, you're harping on the same old string. Yep. Get right again. Hezekiah laying there. He's sick. The Bible says he's a sickness unto death. The preacher comes in and he says, thus saith the Lord. Set thine house in order, for thou shalt die and not live. When that day comes, and I'll just tell you, I can say that this morning because that day will come to all of us sometime. We don't know when. I hope we live till we're 100. But we probably won't. So you know what we ought to do? Then we ought to live today for God. I don't know if you got a month to get right with God, so you know what you ought to do this morning? We ought to get right this morning. I don't know how long you have before you meet God, so don't wait to make it right with God and get saved. Make it right this morning. Get saved. Bow your head and close your eyes. Let me ask you, is there anybody here this morning that says, preacher, man, you preached on making it right, and I tell you, I don't know that I'm saved. If I died this morning, I don't know that I'd go to heaven. Hey, this is no time to play with that. Be honest, preacher. I think I really may need to get saved. That's been my problem. The Lord showed me. I think that salvation is my issue. Raise your hand. Let me see it this morning. Is there anybody? Preacher, I'm not saved. Just slip it up and down again. I see that hand, buddy. God bless you. Anybody, preacher? I'm not saved. I don't want to die like this. I need to make it right. All right. I see a bunch of saved people then. I know a bunch of you raised your hand a while ago and said, I'm saved. How many of you, be honest. Be honest now. In your heart of hearts, there's something the Lord said, boy, you need to get that right. Maybe it's something in your own life to get it right with God. Raise it up. God bless you. Hands are up everywhere. How many of you the Lord touched you about? Boy, there's some things you ought to get right with your husband or wife. Be honest. Raise it up. And there's hands up everywhere. Thank you. Maybe you ought to take each other by the hand and make your way down to an altar. It'd be a good morning to get an altar, wouldn't it? When's the last time you knelt down together and prayed with each other? Sure would be good. Maybe you got it wrong with somebody. Maybe kids, you got something wrong with a mom and daddy and you ought to get it right. Maybe you got something wrong with your children, parents, and you ought to get it right with those children. But how many of us would say, preacher, man, there's some things I just need to get right. Let's all raise it up one more time. Raise it up. If your hand's up, why don't we come to this altar? Come on. Come on. That's right. Let's all stand together. I'll make it easier for you to step out of your pew. That's right. Let's come get on our knees. It'd be a good morning to get some things right. Set thine house in order. Let's do it if we're going to die. Let's do it if we're going to be a disciple. Let's do it if we want to make a difference.
Thank you for choosing to watch this sermon preached at Heritage Baptist Church. Heritage Baptist Church is located at 1843 Peaksville Road, Locust Grove, Georgia, 30248. You can contact us at 770-320-7771. Visit us on the web at www.hbcga.com.